pick and choose.
Yeah.
And so it was a thing. But I want to do some things on my own rather than looking for other people.
Makes sense.
No shortage of projects, just a different direction.
How do we put your Facebook Live on our Facebook?
I have no idea.
I don't know either.
So
I don't know how to do it until after it's done, and then you can share the
video. Yeah, I can share the video if it's done.
Because I found it on your page one day, and that's how I was able to interact with you and Amanda.
Was it live?
Yeah.
Or was
yeah.
It, was that because you were recording?
Mm.
Or do you share my...
Probably because you weren't here that day.
So
okay, here you are.
Can you hear them?
Good, I'm hidden behind the cameras until I finish my croissant. Share now. Okay, so you go to Mark's page and then click share now.
Can you hear? Oh,
what?
Off of mine? It's really loud.
Oh,
yeah,
turn it down.
It'll go
how do
back.
I turn
it'll,
it down?
Yeah, the volume is where you plug it.
There. You should have a box.
Two knobs, inner and outer.
Okay, so if you go to his. Yep. So if you go to Mark's page and then you click share and then share now with friends,
okay.
It'll.
Yeah,
on your page.
Let's do mic checks and guests. These
Mark
are highly directional mics.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, speak directly into them.
Testing.
Unlike, well, I'm not there yet.
Yeah.
she has an omnidirectional.
Right.
So
there you go.
Sorry, we got about 5 minutes. Let's see what.
Oh, watch it'll do here. Oops.
Okay, I've got it on my page now, and I can see it for questions and stuff. Is that
this?
Are these that loud? They are.
Mine's pretty loud.
Testing. Test. A little closer. I'm like eating it right now.
Shared it.
Good? Louder. Good? Okay, thank you.
How about now? Testing.
Mark.
Jerry. Can you hear me, Jerry? Rachel?
Rachel, test. Hi.
Katie, testing.
Katie.
Testing.
Four minutes, 7 seconds.
Great.
Should we move the camera?
I'm hiding behind the computer.
I have not had any coffee.
The water?
Yeah.
Water. You have water in there?
Sure.
You can coffee in it too if you want.
I would love a cup of coffee. Yeah. I don't know if I'm going to grab one.
I don't either, so I don't know how to make
Katie,
it.
Katie, do you want some water?
Sure.
Rachel, you said water?
I'm fine.
You're fine?
I brought a water.
Okay.
If I go potty, you might eat again.
Ooh, I have to go too. Okay.
Let's go really fast.
Go again. That will be tested. Went live. Don't run away.
Here. So how many kids do you have?
I have one son. He was 9 months old. Little baby.
Yeah, wow.
Yeah. Yes.
What,
which was fun.
January?
December.
December what?
8th.
Okay. I'm
yeah.
17th.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Christmas baby?
Yes. He's a little bit further removed.
Yeah,
Christmas,
he is.
Which is nice.
Yeah. It's kind of the start of December before.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because mine would get people. What did you combine presents?
Right, and you're like, hey, I'm a kid. I want a birthday present, and then I want a Christmas present.
So I know some people with our friends of our kids who had December birthdays where they'd have like a half birthday in June.
Yeah.
Yeah, right. Birthday parties.
Totally, because the kids love summer parties.
Oh, yeah.
You know? And then you can take the kid, put the kids all outside, and it's a lot easier than wrangling them indoors.
Yeah, in December, yeah.
Yeah.
Whereabouts do you live?
I live over by Pavilions and Lomans Plaza.
Okay.
Over Fair Oaks
area. Nice,
yeah.
Yeah, that's a good area.
What about you?
We're in Rockland.
Okay.
Lived in Elk Grove for a number of years and then moved to Rockland in 2006.
We thought you decided to
go for a walk.
Right.
We needed some more exercise. It's all about heart health this day.
Yes.
How many kids do you have, Rachel?
Two.
How old are they?
Two
I know
and
you'll
four.
Tell us, but
yeah.
Curious.
Two and four.
Boy, girl.
Two and a half, three, four and a half. Paisley and Pepper, they're both girls.
What
okay.
cute names.
Oh,
thank
I love
you.
That
Pepper.
We worked hard to find those names. And they named the dog Penny, too, so it could be really confusing.
Wow.
Jeez.
Oh. Yeah.
Is your husband's name start with a P?
No. David.
David.
It's generic. That's
yeah.
why. He's
yeah.
David, I'm Rachel. It's like, no, we're not doing that to the kids. There'll be no more Sarahs or Johns or, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
I think the number one baby name, male or female, is nothing generic.
Oh,
in the last couple years, it's always something.
Yeah,
generic.
Unisex.
Handlebar or something.
Lots of trendy hipster names.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
And lots of old names coming back, right?
What's your son's name?
Dominic.
Dominic.
Now, I can't be argued that it's hipster because it's an old family name. It's just a traditional family name.
There you go.
Although I'm sure it's on some of those lists.
My kids both got middle name family names.
Mm-hmm.
So it's Paisley Lou after my grandma.
Oh, that's nice.
And Pepper Leanne after my husband's mom and her twin sister.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. I fought and I was like, that's so country. And he's like, really, Lou?
Okay,
you win. You're right.
That's so
are we good? Good morning. Welcome to Beyond the Numbers on Money 105.5, Wednesday, October 4th. Katie here, joining me, my co-host Mark.
Good morning, Katie. How are you?
It's getting nippy outside at night.
I know, right?
Walked out this morning and went, whoa.
Yeah, a little bit chilly.
It's cool, it's fall.
Yes.
Get your pumpkin spice latte, put on your scarf.
Right.
Get your boots.
Yes,
it's
yes.
Fall.
Yeah, jacket, sweaters. Every morning, because I walk over to Starbucks in the mornings when I get to work, and I always don't need a jacket. I haven't needed one in a few months, but now it's getting back to the time where I need one.
Totally.
So, yeah.
So, we're talking women in business this morning.
Yes, our theme this month.
Super excited. That's right, for Breast Cancer Awareness Month in October,
yes.
And the kind of a woman-themed month here and there, so that's very exciting. A couple of guests joining us today for a panel discussion. Katie and Rachel, welcome.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Good morning.
So, can you go ahead and introduce yourselves?
I'm Katie Taylor. I am an attorney and a mom of one. I have a son who's 9 months old named Dominic.
I'm Rachel Zillner. I work full-time my day job at Safe Credit Union. When I'm not there, I'm a part owner of an escape room business called Beat the Room. If I'm not doing that, I'm managing our rental properties, and I'm also the chair of Metro Edge. Mom of two, Paisley and Pepper. They're 4 and 2.
How do you have time for all you do? That's a lot.
You don't.
That's
what
we're
talking about today.
Escape room.
Yes.
That's interesting. I've never done that before. Have you done that, Katie?
No, but I want to.
Your whole life will be different.
Can you tell us a little bit about how that works and how long you're in there and all that type of stuff?
Yeah, sure. An escape room is kind of like a murder mystery dinner, but condensed into 1 hour, and
wow.
You have to figure out the puzzles to escape the space. So rooms at our place are 50 minutes to 1 hour, and you come in, you get immersed in whatever the experience is, whether it's, we have a pirate theme, a detective theme, a secret society theme, now we have a prohibition game, we're opening in Vacaville. It gets pretty entertaining.
Kind of is a parallel to what I understand motherhood is like, right?
Right. It's an escape room.
Yeah.
Find
your
way out.
Yes.
Find
your way, right?
Where is it located?
We have two locations, one in Rockland and one in Vacaville.
Okay, great.
And is it teams that go in there?
You know, we do a lot of date night, a lot of birthday parties, a lot of Boy Scout groups,
wow.
But the sweet spot is really the team building with a lot of corporate events. It's a great way to get people together and get cranial. Instead of, you know, hanging out, watching a movie, bowling, whatever.
Right.
Those are great for camaraderie, but this really makes you
come together and figure out who has what skills and who doesn't have what skills and how people perform under pressure. It's really fun.
Interesting.
Definitely on my list to check it out.
Yeah, absolutely. Same.
Well, welcome, ladies. Mark, I'll be participating in the discussion as well, because I don't know if you know this, but I'm actually a woman.
Yes, I knew that.
Okay. Just checking. It's hard to tell sometimes these days.
No, you definitely love, and you bring fantastic energy to the show every week. And I think it's much different than, because the show used to have two men hosting, myself and another guy, of course, and now we've got Katie, and it's a different dynamic, so.
Okay.
Yes, I'm very aware that you're a woman.
Okay,
yes.
Just good, so there's
Thank
no
you.
Questions about
no.
that.
Now, you're not a mother yet.
I'm not.
Not even of a dog or a cat.
We have a cat.
But you have a cat?
Yes.
Okay.
I don't
know
if it counts. He's pretty self-sufficient.
Cats a little more different than dogs.
But everything is one more thing, you know, which we were talking about a little bit off the air. So, I mean, let's launch right into it. The goal today would be to have, we want to have an open dialogue and really talk about what it means to be a woman in a male-dominated industry, lawyer, banker. I represent, you know, the financial side of things. So between the three of us, I think kind of have that covered as far as male-dominated industries.
Yes.
Where do we want to start? What's on your mind?
Well, I'll start. So one of the things that I've been kind of looking into and researching personally, because I find it a really interesting topic as I progress in my career as an attorney, is the kind of role and the evolution of women in the law industry. So if you look at the statistics, women in college are about 60%. And then when you move to law school, it lowers to about 52%. Then once you look at law firms and look at senior attorneys, women, it goes down to about 35%. And then when you look at just shareholders and partners, you're looking at about 10% women, 90% men. So those statistics are stark when you look at them and kind of see how women in their career progress, and to see the evolution of what's happening and why are women not in these leadership roles, particularly within the private sector.
And I think we see the same thing in the accounting industry,
what I was gonna say.
Where more than half of all of the students are women. And then we look at the stats of, not my current firm, but a firm I came out of, we had 27 partners, two of which were women, one of them did not have children.
Right.
And you go, where are they going? What's happening?
Right.
And I think you see that in public accounting.
Right. I mean, this
so.
Is not exclusive to the, you know, to the law sector at all.
Right.
If you look at politics, if you look at potentially nonprofits and other areas in the private sector, it's kind of happening on a widespread basis. And I think it's something we need to talk about and figure out.
So where do they go? It's a question. And you interview, I mean, you hire people all the time. Do you
right.
talk to, do you find women that have left the workforce at some point and come back?
Yeah, I mean, I find
and
all
the
humans that
of,
leave the workforce, especially now, maybe with an ailing parent, they
right.
have to leave to take care of. It's not exclusive to just men or women.
Right.
It's interesting. I just got an annual report for a large national payroll processor that I happen to own stock in, and I was reading through the annual report and the list of all of the key executives. 13 key executives, one female of the bunch.
Right.
So it's not just finance and law, banking and CPA, it's everywhere. And this is, I mean, pseudo financial payroll processor,
right.
but this is a large publicly traded company,
right.
and we're seeing the same thing.
Yeah.
So I think part of it may be opportunity. So we hire people that are like us, right? We tend to sort of gravitate towards people that resonate with the same things we do. We also give opportunity to people who are like us.
Right.
So if historically a law firm, for example, has been male dominated, those opportunities are more likely to go to the folks that, you know, emulate those in leadership roles, the men. And I think as women, it's our job to speak up and say, hey, what about me? This is what I can do too, so that we can get a seat at that table.
Definitely.
Yeah, and I mean, I do think industry matters a lot. So my day job is at excuse me, State Credit Union, and credit unions are notorious for being mostly female employed.
Okay.
Now that's totally different than a lot of the other industries. So
right.
we have kind of a philosophy that women have more of a heart for nonprofit, right? So you come work at the nonprofit financial institution. But where that changes is when we get into the leadership space. So locally in Sacramento, our credit unions do a pretty good job of it. I mean, we look at our largest credit union in the region. It's had two female CEOs back to back. But my credit union has done a wonderful job of that as well. As they continue to grow, we put more and more women into leadership at the executive level. But that doesn't mean that it's not a problem across the rest of the space. I get it a lot in the entrepreneur space.
Right. Right.
You know, I get treated differently by anyone I'm interacting with.
You're listening to Beyond the Numbers on Money 105.5. If you want to call into the show, our number is 866-576-1055. We would love to take your questions, and we'll continue the discussion when we get back.
That's what the waving's for.
Yeah.
I was like, what is that?
We forgot to tell you, sorry.
That's funny.
I'm like, can we out? He will get, the producer will give direction, and I'll give you like 2 minute ones, so we can kind of start wrapping for a break. And
good. I was like, we're jazz
dancing. This is,
yeah.
Or Katie, it's like,
stop.
No, that's awesome.
How are we doing on, I lost our Facebook feed. What the heck? What did I do?
We can see you.
You can?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I know, I was behind the pole. Okay, cool. So, some of the questions that I had, and we can you know, facing challenges, what kind of challenges have you faced, why, what can we do to overcome them, balancing having a career, how prioritizing, thoughts about Sheryl Sandberg and Lean In type stuff, you know, what we're seeing in the media about women making pennies on the dollar compared to men, and what thoughts on that are. So, you guys, tell me what you want to talk about, and we'll go in that direction.
If there are women that are interested, I have a lot of comments about balance and how it doesn't exist.
Yeah,
I have thoughts on that too.
Yeah.
Well, that's good. Let's talk about it.
Okay.
And then you said you work with employment law?
I do. Background is employment law.
So have you seen, or do you have experiences you can speak to that about women and, I don't know, things they've faced, overcome, issues you see, something like that? Is there a tie in there at all?
I think I haven't actually handled much pregnancy discrimination cases.
Okay.
It's more wage and hour issues with, as we were discussing earlier, breaks, rest periods, and I do governmental work currently too, so basically representing organizations that are getting in trouble with California regulatory agencies. So I think I can speak more to just kind of my personal, how do I balance it, what are the priorities, balance in quotes, right?
Balance.
I have opinions also about what I see on the hiring side, as far as if I'm interviewing two candidates with the same skill set, the man is more likely to ask for more money and the woman's more likely to undersell herself. And I see it over and over again, and I don't know why.
Women have to.
And we're back.
We're back.
Money 105.5. Here we are.
What's the number again if people want to call in and ask questions?
866-576-1055, as in Money 105.5.
Yes. Okay.
866-576-1055. And you can also find us streaming live and message in your questions or comments as well.
Yes. And then you can comment to my Facebook, yours, or Rachel's, right? All three of ours?
Yep.
Okay. And our guest today, Rachel Zillner.
Hi, everybody. Good morning.
And Katie
Taylor.
Taylor.
Yes, good morning.
Katie Taylor with a local law firm.
Cool. Well, we're talking women in business. It's a big topic.
It's a huge topic.
Off the air.
Balance. Didn't we talk about balance?
I was going to say off the
air
and talking about how it's a miracle that we all got here this morning, got here on time, and with your shoes match, hopefully, mind you.
I do.
Walked out with two shoes that didn't match. It's happened.
Yeah.
You said something about how many bags did you walk out of the house with?
Absolutely.
So me, well, I had a backpack.
That's it.
So, yeah. How about you?
Right. I have a lunch bag.
Okay.
Because you got to eat healthy and meal plan, right?
Yeah.
I have my briefcase.
Okay.
I have my purse.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I have a supplemental bag of gym bags / books and other things like that. And today, I'm going to the Imagine Dragons concert tonight, so I also have a change of clothes. So five bags.
Now, as a mom, you have to add to that, okay? You've got a huge diaper bag. You might have a car seat.
A stroller.
A child in it, perhaps.
Yes, perhaps.
It's just, I think, it's a visual representation of the juggling act that we do on a daily basis, I think.
Right.
So your son, nine months old.
I have a son, Dominic, who's 9 months old, and he's just reached that stage where he wants to be crawling and standing up on everything, and now we're grabbing his hands and helping him kind of slowly walk towards us. It's really fun. He's active, and it's at the point where his personality is really coming through.
So how long after his birth, after he's born, did you come back to work?
So I took off about 4 months,
okay.
which was a good amount of time for me. What I didn't realize is that 4 months, often babies hit a sleep regression, which means they revert to sleeping less, which means I'm sleeping less.
Yes, of course.
So it was a tough transition going back to work and all of a sudden being up three, four times in the middle of the night. But we survived and we made it.
So did you go back to the same schedule you had before?
I did. I kind of eased back into work. So I for the first couple of weeks, I was working fewer hours and then progressed back to full time.
One of the things that we were talking about briefly off air is how to say no and saying no to things. And this big thing now, FOMO, right? Fear of missing out. Have you heard that one?
Yes.
It's like FOMO, I have to say yes to everything all the time because I don't want to miss out on anything. And what that looks like, you don't want to say no at work and miss the opportunity for a promotion or to get in front of somebody or progress your career, but you also don't want to miss watching your baby take his first steps.
Right, and it is a challenge still. I think that it's something you continue to struggle with as your kids get older, and Rachel, you can speak to this, but certainly while, you know, as focused as you may be on your career and as fulfilling as your job may be, it is hard when you have your little one at home and you want to be there for them and you don't want to miss out on big milestones or even small milestones.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So I think it's about, I think we just need to talk about the fact that women still struggle with it, no matter how old their kids are. Rachel, you can speak to that.
Sure, yeah. I mean, I look to put limitations on my week of I'm only going to be gone 3 nights a week, and sometimes that turns into 4, so the next week I'll look to say only 1 event this week or only 2, because, I mean, this week, for example, I was working out at our business all weekend, so I didn't see my kids all weekend and haven't actually for like 4 months. Monday night I had an event. Last night we had an event. Tonight I've got a celebration for Metro Edge. You know, I won't see my kids until late tonight for the first time in 3 days, right? Besides snuggling in the morning, and it gets a little tough. But I don't believe in mommy guilt. So what I tell myself is dads do this all the time. It's okay. They'll forgive me and I'll make the space later.
Right.
So trying to be available when I'm home and not on social media, otherwise the guilt sets in.
And I think that's really important because I'm sure you hear it more than I do, not being a parent. Oh, well, mom should be home with their children.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's a personal choice that, well, I want to provide for my family. I want to contribute. I want to apply that college education that I paid for. And it's a part of my identity. And I don't want to feel bad about the fact that I'm choosing to work and be a mom.
Yeah, and I think it goes both ways, right? Because that guilt, women, we're so awesome. We, like, blame each other for everything and, like, throw daggers. Like, you can't do anything right. So, you know, women who go to work, you know, get shunned for being at work instead of being at home. Women who stay home get shunned for choosing to be at home and not going to work. So it's ugly. What I tell women who stay home is, dude, hats off to you. That is the toughest job on the planet, to be home with your kids all day.
Mm-hmm.
I have mad respect for that, and I could never do it. Like, I would be the worst stay-at-home mom on the planet. Like, bonbons and kids taking care of themselves. But being at work, I remind myself when I start to feel really bad about it that I'm setting a good example.
Absolutely.
My girls will love this. They will want to go to school and collect information to share with them. Like, look, mommy did this thing and did this article. Yay. Right?
And realistically, we work, and this is the bottle of wine dinner table conversation. It's coming back to me now. We work for money.
Yes.
I mean, I'd probably do it 12, 15 hours a week for free when I felt like it. Reality is that we do it
for
a paycheck.
Yes, absolutely.
So providing for your family, having a dual income household is very helpful.
Yes.
And I think part of the problem, too, is if you look at social media, Instagram, for example, Instagram is a very dangerous place for moms because it is just a picture. It's kind of like a magazine photo, right? It's a photo shoot that just happens to be on your cell phone, easy access.
Mm-hmm.
And we have these images of these quote-unquote perfect moms who are looking beautiful, fit, and being hands-on moms and also making money at the same time.
Right.
And while it may work for those few Instagram moms, it is not reality for the rest of us. And I think we need to remember that. It's very easy to fall into the trap of looking at blog posts and websites out there that just promote this concept of being the perfect mom and woman. And, you know, if you compare that to men, the same kind of comparisons are just not there in terms of how media portrays the perfect dad.
No, men have different issues.
Sure, right.
So, but how many blogs are there for moms, working moms?
Oh my gosh,
countless.
I hate to tell you, it's kind of endless. us, which is why it can be, as I said, a negative space.
And
for that, a lot
and
of
that's
people.
Social media in general. Right?
Sure.
And social media in general can portray such a different picture, or just a piece, right? A picture of a working mom with her kids there while she's
right.
getting
mm-hmm.
the work. Great, and they don't show all you know
no.
all the stuff she did,
right.
staying
the
up all night with
the
kids.
Off
yeah, exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
In the car, yes. getting into the.
Yeah,
so
why
who
wants to see that?
It's not reality.
You
got to
post both, right? Like,
yes.
be real. Like,
mm-hmm.
here's what we were doing 10 seconds before. One of my girlfriends on a Bali does that. Like, here's what the kids were doing for a half hour. Here's the one perfect
mm-hmm.
picture
yeah.
I got.
Right.
You know, it's great.
And I think speaking to kind of society and judging others, I've found in kind of mom's groups and the mom community that I've met here in town, there isn't a lot of judgment as to what the other is doing. It's our own inner critic, you know, that
Absolutely.
Voice inside of you that kind of questions and wonders and doubts yourself at times that
right.
you kind of get swayed
Am I
by.
Being enough? Am
sure.
I doing enough?
Is this the right choice for my family and for me?
And especially, I don't know if you gals are supervising staff. Sometimes I go, well, am I checking in enough? Am I present enough? Has the pendulum swung too far in the other direction?
Mm-hmm.
And there's a phrase, you can have it all if you do it all.
That's so not true.
I agree with you.
Yeah, I mean, I don't believe in that whole balance of, you know, you do so much over here and then you have work-life balance. Like, there's a few things that I learned to change to find space. Like, I do not set an alarm clock. Don't set an alarm clock. You wake up when you wake up because your body wakes up. I mean, in my world, it's because my kids got up and fell into bed
of course,
with us. Yeah. But, you know, if you're late, you're late. It's life. Things happen. You know, take care of it. I don't buy into a lot of, like, makeup. I mean, you see, I put on eye makeup, I put on concealer, and I walk out the door. You know, I brush my hair, I throw it up because it doesn't matter. People aren't going to remember what my hair looked like or what my, you know, makeup looked like or what lip color I chose. It's, am I there? Am I present? Can I get it done? And I also think you have to get a network, right? I don't even pick my own clothes. I have an awesome stylist because I suck at picking my own outfits. Like, people, I walk out and they're like, really, that doesn't look so hot on you, or I wouldn't feel good. But hiring a stylist who comes in and says, here are great outfits for you to put on and wear, like, oh my God, life-changing. I don't spend that time anymore worrying about it. Or, you know, hey, we've got someone who can help me keep my mental health balanced. I go see a therapist at least once a month to check in and say, yeah, fill in that mom guilt thing. Like, I need some help here. Or I'm feeling the weight of the world that I'm carrying around with all the crazy stuff that's going on. Or my kid did this thing and I didn't catch it. Crap. You know, and I think that's an important piece of finding that balance.
Absolutely. It takes a village, right?
It does.
It does. And for me, when I think about balance, I think that's the wrong word that we often use in our vernacular.
Yes.
It, like, if I visualize what does balance mean to me, I think of a teeter-totter, right? And the idea that, oh, if balance means it's perfectly flat and there's equal weight on both sides, that's unrealistic.
Yeah.
Oftentimes, work is a huge weight and the teeter-totter goes like this.
That's
and
right.
work becomes a priority for a week while you're struggling with deadlines
that's
and
right.
client meetings. Oftentimes your child is sick and all of a sudden the teeter-totter goes in the opposite direction. I think we need to be careful in how we like approach the concept of juggling multiple things. That's how I view it.
And I think as the workplace gets more flexible, we can accommodate our lives. I mean, I don't have children in the fold yet, but I do have times when I need to take personal time
mm-hmm.
and, you know, I can go sit in the pedicure chair and write the speech for the conference I'm presenting at and do both at the same time so I can take that space and also get things done at the same time.
Yeah, and as strong women, I think it's our job to reach back and support other people, right? So my office is also a mother's room for other women in the office that don't want to go to the lactation room to sit down and pump because it's sad and boring, you know? So hang out in my office, do what you need to do, you know, and take care of it. Or, hey, something's happening with someone's mom. They don't have kids. I'm not going to say, well, you don't have kids. It's not right. No, you go home. You take care of it. We'll all be here. We'll pick up that work. But
right.
You got to support other women, too.
I agree.
Absolutely. When we get back from the break, I want to talk about the salary gap. We hear a lot in the industry about women make, 80 cents for every dollar that men make. And I have some opinions about that in the hiring world, and I'm sure these ladies as well in male-dominated industries. And Mark, you've been awful quiet over there.
I know. I've got some thoughts here and there. But
are you afraid to speak up for fear of...
No. You know, I one of my thoughts is that sometimes I, as a father, I feel similarly, right? So, I mean, there's times when I think I'm missing my kids' stuff and I hate it. Like, my daughter is going to be 18 in a couple weeks and I have to be in Minneapolis because that's where our home office is, and so I have to go there. So I'm going to miss her birthday. Mm-hmm. And I hate it, mm-hmm. but what are you going to do? And the good thing is my wife will be able to be there, mm-hmm. which is great. Right. So one parent is there. As you mentioned, at least one parent is able to do that. And so I, you know, I don't know if I'm the norm or whatever, but I get that, I don't know what you call it, dad guilt. But anyway, I get the guilt, like, I wish I could spend that time with my daughter.
Yeah, so. I guess it should be, it's parent guilt.
Yeah, I think there parent guilt is probably more, yeah, it's a better descriptor.
We'll be right back on Money 105.5.
Now,
is this not learning to fly?
No, it's that.
It sounded like
blue eyes. What's her name? Betty Davis eyes.
It's like the same opening.
Yeah.
That was horrible, by Tom Petty. More each all these rockers when I was younger are all dying off.
Well, cocaine is bad for your heart.
Cocaine.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Cocaine is a hell of a drug.
I mean, it's not super good on the heart, so that might have something to do with it.
Was he?
I don't know in his later days, but in his earlier years, he certainly was. I went through a phase where I read a ton of biographies on. I did the Eric Clapton biography and the Patti Boyd biography. She was married to him, you know, after George Harrison and the Beatles, and I just tore through them all. So.
Did you read the Keith Richardson's?
No.
I remember reading his some years ago. Yeah, at that point, 30 years ago, he'd already got through seven blood.
Yeah, you're like, how are you still alive right now?
All the drugs out of the system.
It's a mess.
Yeah. My only issue with that, with Monday, was, you know, Tom Petty died, and that's awful. It's sad. But on Monday, Tom Petty was one more person.
Right.
He's like now we're at 59, right? And so it's like,
yeah, it's the timing.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can't control that, but yeah, boy, it would have been a different time.
Oh, yeah, it would have been a different day.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah.
It's been a rough year. A lot of that pressure.
Yeah. Well, we're going to start seeing more of that as the rise of, there's more celebrities now than there were 50 years ago, so more of them are aging. And, you know.
Well, the big news is lately is what Khloe and all the Kardashian kids are pregnant. So
they are.
And the moms
are.
On Instagram.
Yeah.
Oh,
they don't follow
Kardashian. And Snapchat.
Snapchat too, yeah.
I'm
not really on Snapchat.
I don't even know what it is.
My kids love Snapchat.
Well, my kids
really?
Love it, so
I they can put the
them.
Filters.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh,
oh, yeah.
You have to show them.
Is that
right?
That
yeah.
thing
so
with
cool.
the where people put ears and buttons?
Yes,
yes.
The little like
yeah.
cute little
yeah.
eyelashes for the girls.
You can also
yeah.
record
oh,
storage.
So, cool.
So like my daughters, they'll do my one is at San Diego State, or
mm-hmm.
she'll do Snapchats of her date so I can watch and see others. Look at this, she's with the roommates.
Yeah,
oh,
that's
it's
actually
like
useful
cool. yeah,
use
that
of social media because then you can share with that.
Geotags.
No, what does that do?
It tells someone in the world where she is.
Oh.
You gotta turn that location off so
hers?
You don't get some crazy person.
But I like on my phone doing find friends so I can see exactly where she's at. So would that affect
that means so can the stalkers. You gotta turn it off. You gotta get one of those, they have a new thing. It's like a little tag. I can't remember what it's called. No, you put it in their backpack or whatever and then you can track your
phone. Oh, okay.
Because it's your own app. Oh my gosh, what is
that?
I'm old school.
I used to be
in
able to track
ways.
My dad like that. Like
yeah.
I let him
do.
Figure where he's driving.
You think? Are you? That's funny. I'm old school in some ways. Yeah. Like I still like printing out paper and writing on paper
yep.
and reading like long things on paper.
I
don't
do
actually like scrolling through and print, you know, Word documents.
So
yeah.
I
want
to print it
out.
On the screen.
No, I
want to
print it out. I feel like your eye catches more things too when it's right in front of you on a piece of paper
yeah.
than just staring at a screen.
The screen.
That's
what
yeah.
Like if I'm
we
doing
spend too much time
a letter
with
or something, like
that.
I have to print it out.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Type it up rather versus writing it.
Right.
But then
print
edit
it out.
Yeah.
Edit.
Mm-hmm. Edit it. Yeah. I guess I just get tired of editing and re-editing my own stuff.
Your brain stops. Like when, if it's the words you've written.
Exactly. No.
Yeah.
No,
so do you guys come up with your own themes and ways
do.
To get people out of the rooms?
We do. Yeah. We write. We do. Yeah. It's Prohibition is coming up and running. I'm getting ready to do a new captain or like a pirate themed game.
That's fun.
It's a lot of fun. You also feel
that.
Like a crazy person. Everything looks like.
And we're awesome. Back. Money 105.5 Beyond the Numbers. Mark and Katie here.
Good morning, everyone. Happy Wednesday.
Talking with
yes.
Rachel and Katie.
Hi.
Hello.
If you have questions you want to ask Rachel and Katie or Katie or Mark.
Anybody.
866-576-1055. Did I get that right?
You got it.
Purely memory. Awesome.
before the break, we said when we got back, we were going to talk about the pay differential, which is a big issue that we're hearing a lot about with, you know, this, what seems to be a recent uprising in feminism, if you want to call it that. Or
feminism, that word has such a negative connotation in some people's minds.
It does.
It does, yeah.
Well, I think when I used to hear the word feminism, I would think, oh, you know, burning bras and revolution, and now it's taken a completely different turn.
Yeah, I think it's totally changed as we've progressed in modern society. I think feminism is has a positive connotation,
good,
at least for me and
good
people in my community.
Yeah, I agree with that. And talking about the pay differential, it's an issue. It's something that needs to be addressed.
I see it in hiring, but I will tell you that what I see is women are not asking for their worth, and men tend to be more bold.
Well, and I've heard that before, and let's maybe talk about that a little bit later once we finish this thought out. But I've heard that a lot of times that in the workplace, you know, or in meetings, you know, sometimes they say that men will be more vocal, more aggressive, I think is the word that I've heard, unlike women who don't act that way. So,
sure,
interesting to get your guys' thoughts on that, but
yeah,
but
sure,
going back,
I mean, like,
to the pay.
It gets tough and broad. Like, I would say my reputation at work is probably one of the more aggressive people in the meeting room, asking questions, asking why we're doing what we're doing.
And have you always been that way in business, or is this something you have, yourself, you've seen a change, or?
No, I mean, as I get older, I think I get more mature and less, I get more, what's the word I'm looking for, like, less impassioned about it,
right,
which is a great,
jaded.
Yeah.
You just don't care as much.
Well, it's better, because I used to be perceived as someone who cared too much,
mm-hmm,
or I had, like, a personal agenda about what
right
it was I was trying to fight for. So getting a little perspective about it to say, it's not life or death, it's just the right thing to do.
It sounds like you've taken the emotion out of it, which
right
has made it more kind of pragmatic, almost.
Yeah,
mm-hmm,
absolutely.
Yeah, which is, I think, effective. I think one of the things that occurs is implicit gender bias, right? It's these unconscious prejudices that we have and towards, you know, a particular gender, and I
yes
think it starts very young. I actually was listening to a podcast the other day, and mom was talking about the difference between little boys and little girls, and she asked a room full of three little girls, you know, are you hungry? Do you want something to eat? And the girls all looked at each other, kind of for consensus, waiting for someone else to say how they felt. She asked the room of three little boys, and they all shouted out, yeah, we're hungry, yeah, give us something to eat. Now, this is just one example, but it speaks to how we socialize little girls and little boys differently from a very young age. And I think that as you know, as children get older and they're in the workplace, it's still present, but just in a different way.
Right.
Agreed, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
So what do you see when you go through hiring? What has been your experience, Katie?
So my experience, and this is pretty much across the board in industries, but I'm in the finance space most of the time, of course, is that I have two candidates, all other things equal. The male candidate will say, you know, let's say that they're both making the same amount of money right now. They're both making $100,000. And I say, what's your bottom line? What's it going to take to make a move? The man is more likely to say $120,000, and the woman is more likely to say, for example, well, if I can get into a better environment, I'm okay with a lateral move. And my advice
mm-hmm
to her is, you're worth more, so here's what I think you should ask for. Mm-hmm. But without that coaching, if she
mm-hmm
was, you know, doing it on her own without
right
me as a hiring coach, she would probably take the lateral move. And so, you know, my soapbox around this is really, is it really the employer? I don't think so. I don't think that employers are out to get women and oppress us and hold us down. I think that we're not asking because it's scary, because we have this self-imposed guilt that we're not really worth it and maybe we don't deserve it, so we shouldn't even ask because we'll be perceived as foolish, rather than putting ourselves out there and asking. And the men are more likely to just ask.
I agree with you so much. I read a great study a couple of years ago that said that men are 7 times more likely to apply for a job that they're underqualified for than women.
Mm-hmm.
Because men will look at the skills and say, I got most of that. And women will look at it and go, oh, I'm missing that one thing, so it's not a good fit.
Right.
So since learning that, I've been trying to educate all of my female
mm-hmm
friends when they find jobs they're interested in. Just do it. Apply.
Absolutely.
Do you know any other man would apply for that? You got to get it, girl.
And
what
I think we see the same thing in, like, performance reviews. Women can be so critical of their own selves that in performance reviews, you often see women giving themselves lower ratings, providing kind of negative feedback on their own work, versus if you look at male performance reviews, they're, as you said, they're kind of more positive, and there's kind of less criticism in their own evaluations of themselves.
Right, which translates over, if that's the metric by which
sure.
you're using to give
right.
raises, then women are going to receive less than men. And then, to me, ladies, that's on us.
So knowing that or taking that into account, what do you do? How do you affect change?
I think there's a number of things that can be done. I think this is a complex problem, obviously.
Of course, yes.
Right. But one of the things as a woman that I, as I progress in my career, that I have decided is really important to me is to mentor other young women, right? And speaking to, you know, 22-year-old female professionals who are just getting into the workforce, I think it's on us to turn around to those women and help them navigate their own career, help them speak up for a raise, help them be confident in the workplace. You know, I've actually, not in my present job, but in the past, have had experiences with, let's say, women who are 20 years older than me, often not helping me in that way, and I think it is the right thing to do, and I definitely am committed to helping younger professionals.
Yeah, I agree that the whole lean in, you know, space has kind of taken our country, and I hope it's something we continue to focus on. And, you know, finding that peer network of women that you feel comfortable with, creating that safe space where you can talk about issues as they come up and get good, sound advice on how
Absolutely.
To handle those situations,
mm-hmm.
and then providing them some mentorship.
I've heard from folks, women get a bad rap. Women are catty. They don't want to help each other. I will tell you that through my career, my best advocates and my best partners in referring business to me and helping grow my practice have been women. And the men have been the haters that have asked me, why do you want to do this? Why do you want to be at the top? Why don't you just want to go have a kid and stay home? You know, they're the ones that have created the sense of competition for me, and the women have been my best supporters.
Well,
interesting. Yeah.
To each their own, you know, because I work with a lot of men, and a lot of men in high positions at my company, and many of them are some of my best supporters of information or mentorship because they have wives.
Sure.
They see experience,
and I'm not trying to
man
bash. I
yeah.
have had some really good male mentors
yes.
as well, Mark.
Yeah,
yes.
I think it just depends on what industry you're in, right? And the companies that you're working for. It can vary in terms of what the organizational structure looks like and the power dynamic.
So where do you find the peer groups you mentioned?
You have to make one. I mean,
if you can't find one, make one, right?
Well,
so.
For me, joining Metro Edge and now being in that leadership space with Metro Edge, I meet tons of super rad under 40 folks to hang out with. They're in that similar space
right.
in their lives, and we come together. I mean, it's not uncommon to be driving to work one morning and call one of my girlfriends and say, hey, what's going on? How do you guys deal with this? What are you doing in the construction space, or what are you doing in the PBID space, or whatever it might be?
There are also some lean-in groups in Sacramento. Inspire Midtown
mm-hmm. yes.
is an awesome organization of young women. Lean-in being Sheryl Sandberg of Facebook.
I was going to say,
fame.
Apparently I'm clueless.
So Sheryl Sandberg,
exactly.
COO of Facebook,
uh-huh.
her book, Lean In, and her
right.
mission is around women need to ask for a seat at the table and, quote, leaning into the conversation.
But we have to set good examples. There was a woman who was an executive at Facebook. It wasn't Sheryl. It was their new CEO that was pregnant. She went out on maternity leave, and she came back in 4 weeks. It's like, what are you
right.
doing? Why
That's
are you,
unrealistic.
I mean,
yeah.
yeah, and why set that expectation to other women? I get, you know, do you? But sometimes you have to think about the example it sets for everyone behind you who now thinks that they have to come back to work
4 weeks,
after they have a
yeah.
baby. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's,
yeah. And one of the things I think we can do as women is learn how to ask for help and be okay with it.
Yes.
And, you know, having a good support team is critical. You know, having a partner, a husband or a spouse who helps you, and it's not just you carrying the mental load of everything that needs to be done. I think as women, we carry the brunt of that, and if we don't vocalize our needs and what can be done to help, then things don't get done.
Well, and the comment I've heard before from women is that, or a couple of women anyway, is that if I ask for help, then I appear weak, and I
yep.
need to not appear weak in front of my male peers.
Mm-hmm.
Sure,
so
looks
I,
like
therefore,
you can't
yeah,
do it.
Looks like you can't do it, therefore I'm not going to ask for help. So.
Yeah, and
how do you
I no longer subscribe to that.
Good.
You know what? It is what it is. You are who you are. If you need help, you need help. You know, and there's nothing wrong with that.
I think we all enjoy being of service to others, and so I
yes.
try to look at it from the perspective of, if I'm not asking, I'm depriving others of the opportunity to be of service to me.
Mm-hmm.
And that's an opportunity that we all enjoy and want to have.
And that's a great perspective. And I don't think everyone prescribes it, though, unfortunately.
Well,
I
say in theory I prescribe to this. But in practice, you know, I feel like I have to do it all. And if I have to ask
you
for
strive
help,
to prescribe.
I feel that guilt You know, I should be able to do, I'm shooting all over myself. I should be able to do all of this.
And I think when it comes to, you know, raising children and being in the workplace, it does take a village. Leaning on your daycare or leaning on family, and not being afraid to kind of, in a sense, outsource all that needs to be done.
Amen. Yeah.
We have to go to break. We'll be right back on Money 105.5.
This is fun, guys.
It is fun.
This is getting my brain juices going to write some things down.
My soul feels lighter. Right?
Are your little ones in preschool?
They go to a Montessori school, which I love. They Country Montessori. They take really good care of the kids. And, you know, I think the smartest thing I ever did was get to know a couple of teachers, and they are our babysitting network. Mm-hmm. I mean, what better professional to watch your kids after hours than the same person who knows them, is qualified to do what they're doing.
Oh, that's good.
I mean,
yeah.
They have wonderful family support as well, but when we have to go outside of their family
space. What part of town are you in?
We're in Carmichael, but the school's in Orangeville, so Fair Oaks, that space. Yeah. It's a bit of a drive, but it's totally worth it. So you guys do this every morning, huh?
Every Wednesday morning.
Oh, every Wednesday. Okay.
I cannot imagine. When I first started the show, it was after being a guest on a guy who had the show 5 days a week.
Oh.
From the afternoons from 4 to 5.
Who was that?
His name was Steve Herbert.
Okay.
He's a real estate guy, and then there was Chris, who was the mortgage broker, instead of the real estate show.
Yeah.
But 5 days a week, they drive, it was 4 o'clock, so they drive from Burnsville, get here at 4 to 5, and then drive back.
Wow.
To Katie's point about how it just takes a chunk out of your day.
Oh, yeah.
1 day a week is enough.
Yeah.
Unless it was your, this was your job.
Yeah.
That's a different story. But
we talked about, I wanted to say, when we get back, this is the last segment, do we want to talk about, like, a personal story of something that you've experienced and how...
Yeah, what you've
how
learned,
you're gonna,
grown...
Advice.
Yeah, some advice. I think I have some advice that talks about, or that touches on just being yourself and not trying to fit the mold of what you think the majority is. Like, in my industry, don't try and be who wears a black or brown or blue suit to work every day. That's my world, right? I wear bright colors to work because that's how I like to dress.
Yeah.
And, you know, don't be afraid to be yourself.
Do the hustle.
Doing the hustle, right?
Every day
it's
we're hustling,
every,
right?
Yeah.
Mark and Katie in the morning on Money 105.5. Rachel and Katie here with us, talking women in business and all things business lady,
things around
boss,
that,
lady.
Yes. Boss lady,
boss lady.
We were talking about self-expression a little bit on the break and how we bring that into the workplace. And it's funny, last night we were chatting about how many business books there are about how to be an aggressive woman in business. There's boss lady, there's how to be the boss without being a bee. There's, you know, Lady in the Corner Office. There's all of these business books, but there aren't a lot about the authenticity in the workplace. And there's no book that I've found that says it's okay to go in the bathroom and cry sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't found that one.
It is okay.
Or if it is, it's not in the business section at Barnes & Noble. It's in the self-help section.
In my office, many men and many women have cried. It's not because I'm mean to them. Promise.
Right.
It's a tissue-safe space.
Right. Well, in my industry, actually, being a lawyer is an ancient profession. The first lawyers were kind of date back to, I think, the first millennium BC, back in ancient Athens.
Is it the second oldest profession?
Right.
As they say.
Right. I mean, it truly is very, very old. And so one of the things that is noted about being in a law firm in particular is the kind of standard uniform of having a navy blue or a black suit on. And as a woman, I don't love dressing like that. I love wearing bright colors, professional outfits, sure, nice dresses, blazers, heels, but I like being me and showing up to work in colors and outfits habits that make me feel happy. So I think one of the biggest pieces of advice I have is be yourself. Don't try and fit the mold of what you think the majority is or is expecting of you. And that goes a long way. I don't think we should, as women in leadership, try and be men. We should be ourselves.
As women in leadership, I agree with that. What about an entry level?
An entry level.
I mean, I think that's a little more challenging, man or woman.
Right.
Absolutely, because you don't have your stripes yet.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
I talk with my tribe about this quite a bit, that now, as Rachel mentioned, I don't worry about it as much because I have some letters behind my name, I have 10 years of experience, blah, blah, blah. But when I was a year out of college, I felt like I had everything to prove and nobody took me seriously. Right. And I barely looked like I had a driver's license.
I would say maybe dress a little bit more conservatively, but still be yourself.
Yeah, I would say when I look at hiring and I see people come through that have a little bit of their personality, that's what I'm actually hiring for, is that personality that fits into my team,
yeah,
as opposed to someone that just looks like they walked off the conveyor belt,
yeah,
of, you know, people who want to be in banking.
Yeah.
Plus,
so,
studies have shown that people are attracted to and drawn to people who are more comfortable, and if you're being genuine, you're going to be more comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
So let me ask you this real quick, going back to your business books, the one about being the boss without being a B.
Mm-hmm.
So what is the issue? Why can't you be a B?
There's a lot of negative connotation that comes along with that, right?
Unless you're Beyonce, because she's
but,
the queen.
Yeah,
of
yeah.
A.
But I mean, again,
how many
if it's
are
if it's a man, that's the alt, the whatever the,
you know,
the same thing would be for man.
I don't think anyone builds a brand by being an A or a B,
agreed,
right?
Yes.
So, you know, I think that's just kind of gone. Now we've learned better to treat people. I mean, it's not gone, right? It still exists. But we have to work hard to say to folks, like, we don't really talk to each other like that, right? And it's up to people in leadership who can push that, you know, a little bit further to say, yeah, we don't talk down to our staff. We don't talk down to coworkers.
Yeah, I would agree with Rachel. I think it's a delicate balance. I think the focus should be on being assertive and confident. And
yes,
hopefully, as we progress in society, it's not viewed as being a B.
Yeah.
One of the things that studies have shown is that women often are interrupted in the workplace. And it's kind of a question of, well, how do you handle that? If a man keeps bulldozing you or interrupting you, how do you kind of speak up without appearing obnoxious or, you know, rude or a B? And there are ways, there are strategies in which you can say, oh, thanks for sharing, John. When you're done, I'd like to wrap up my point, right? That's not me being a B. That's just saying, hey, you interrupted me, and I want to finish what I had to say.
And I think having a sense of humor, and this goes, you know, we talk about this a lot with my team, is we talk at least once a month, are you having fun? Because if we're not having fun, something needs to shift. And I think that goes life in general with how you raise your kids. I mean, you have to have a sense of humor with some of the things that you deal with children,
mm-hmm,
you know, and in the workplace and just in being a human being, and that transcends gender.
Well, I'm getting back to that entry-level person, as I'm thinking about that a little bit more, if you have to be something other than yourself, and I mean, you have to be professional, right? But if it forces you into the black and white box that you just want to be a little pink,
mm-hmm,
then don't work there. Right,
absolutely.
It forced that company to change by having a hard time to find qualified employees because they all want to go work at the cool places where you can have a little bit of personality.
And that goes back to making decisions out of abundance and not out of fear. Well, I have to take this job because if not, I'm not going to get another one.
That's right.
Right.
Don't
and
take the job.
I think one of the important things for entry-level people to learn and to be aware of is this is not the only opportunity out there. You know, there'll be tons that will come your way, and it's about navigating, you know, how do I even get into the career that I want?
Right.
And it's kind of trial and error at the beginning.
Agreed.
Yeah,
so
these girls are talking about the thing, I push my big necklaces, right?
Mm-hmm.
Big, bright, colorful
Let's
necklaces.
See your necklace.
Yes, my big, bright, yellow
yeah,
necklace.
Okay.
Mine's fun shoes. That's
fun
my
shoes.
Thing. A little flair.
Yeah. Love it. When you work for conservative places, you find ways to have
right.
that little,
right.
little
pop of color.
Right.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean I'm wearing my pajamas, but
right.
What are your thoughts, Mark, having a daughter who just went off to college, is going to be entering the workforce and facing some of these challenges? Has she picked a major?
She's thinking tourism and hotel management, I believe.
So no.
She went in undeclared.
Okay.
She went in undeclared. Now she's thinking that, but I don't know if she's going to actually pursue that. So.
Okay. Are your wheels turning about, oh, I need my daughter to watch this. I need to share with her.
It's a good point. I think my wife and I, in raising them, have given them a lot of, what the right wording is, a lot of exposure to different thoughts and stuff. I mean, I don't know. I grew up with, you know, basically raised by a mother and with two sisters, so I'm very much aware, and my mom worked, so I'm very much aware of.
So you know everything there is to know about women.
Not at all. But
next
I think,
week's show is going to be Mark on his own telling everything
no,
he knows
not
about
at all.
Women.
Yeah, well, that's going to be a very short show. But, but I would say that maybe I'm a little woke.
Oh,
that's maybe your young people's vernacular, but yes. A little more woke about, I don't want to say women's issues, because that just, sometimes if you put a label on stuff, it just...
Yeah,
it's
awareness.
And
that's
to add
awareness.
To that,
to
add to that, I think that's great to hear. I think that men are now part of this conversation. It's no longer a woman's conversation. It's a conversation that society is having about how we can promote, advance women. And I think that is key, because without men on board, it'll be more of a struggle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think that, you know, my wife and I both co-parent with our kids, and so they have heard my side of things or my voice throughout all this.
Mm-hmm.
So I just try to, you know, emphasize, like you said, being a service, coming from a place of love and trying to do the best they can. And, you know, and to the extent that they come to me with issues about that they're facing, whatever, some kind of, I don't know what.
Yeah. One
challenge in a certain area, then I'll try to talk through with them to try to figure out what's really going on and what can you really do about it.
Sure. I think one of the things we can do as we raise the next generation of girls or women is just show them that there's an array of options. If they want to be a stay-at-home mom, there's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah.
If they don't want to be a mom at all, that's fine.
Mm-hmm.
And if they want to be a working mom, more power to them.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's kind of where we're at.
Identify your big rocks.
Yeah.
We just have a couple more minutes before we wrap up the show, so I wanted to give everybody a chance to share their parting thought, maybe one gem of wisdom for our listeners that they can take away from the conversation today.
Great.
Yeah, I think my advice would be don't give up if there are negative experiences in the workplace involving discrimination or just struggling to get those leadership roles. Move on to the next company or change industries. I think we just gotta keep progressing and moving forward as a society.
Yeah, I would add, I have a slightly different take on that, that if you're still learning, there's still room to grow there, right? Like whatever it is that happened is something you can learn from and treat other people a little bit differently. But my advice piece is so whatever, but it's about relationships. And I want to say, as a working mom who tries to balance things, and I know Katie can speak to this too, my first priority is to make sure I give time with my husband, right? We get a date night in there, because if we're not healthy, work's not healthy, kids aren't healthy. So,
good point.
Yeah. Well, I hear the music, so I guess it's time.
Yeah.
Thank you, ladies.
Thank you very much for being
Thank
on the
you.
Show today. It's been a great show.
We will see you all next week on Money 105.5, Beyond the Numbers.
Thanks, guys.
Cool.
That was fun.
We thought you said we had 1 minute left, and then all of a sudden
it
was like, get off the stage.
What's
happening right now?
On
the hook.
1 minute is not a minute.
That's it. In radio, a minute is like 40 seconds.
Right. I did fly by. I didn't feel like we were talking for an hour.
I told you. I don't even think we talked about half the things
I know. I'm like, I have all these other thoughts.